Good afternoon, Cloud Native community, and welcome back to London, England. We're here at the end of day three of our coverage at KubeCon and CloudNativeCon. My name's Savannah, I'm here with Paul, and we promise that this last segment is going to be one of our sweetest segments, right, Paul?
Absolutely will be. Yeah, it's going to be a great segment.
I know, I'm pumped. I know you've even got some research and data for us. It's going to be super awesome. Please welcome Sudeep Goswami. Thank you so much for being here, Sudeep.
Thank you. Great to be here.
How you doing? You holding up day three?
Strong. Going strong.
Okay, good. Love to hear it. Love to hear it. We've got, our conversation is going to cover a lot of different things, but since we've got Mr. App Dev next to me and we've got you here, I want to start off by talking a little bit about the market challenges right now. What are you seeing? What are some of the trends?
Yeah, let's start with the influx of a lot of new technologies, tools.
I can't imagine what's catalyzing that. Maybe a little bit of AI, maybe a little bit of acceleration.
You sprinkle AI into everything.
Yeah.
And yes, there's, even before AI, there was an influx of new tools and technologies, and now what's happened is just accelerated at a hyperspace. So that's what we're hearing from customers and users, like they want prescriptive cookbooks, or playbooks, or reference architectures, whatever you want to call that. They're looking for more guidance from vendors like ourselves to help them demystify the maze, so to speak, and give them a set of curated kind of options. You know, be prescriptive, but don't be restrictive.
Yeah.
And that is kind of what we are hearing from them across all of the different kind of solution stacks. You know, whether they're looking to deploy apps, whether they're doing kind of code dev, whether they want to put an API gateway, an API management, whether they want to do AI at scale, it's the same theme we're seeing across the board.
Interesting. So they're looking for that curated toolkit and some bumpers on the bowling lane, so to speak, as continue to navigate
and accelerate. The guardrails are very important.
Yes, the guardrails are important. Paul, I know you have some awesome data on this.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think that what you were talking about, Sudeep, is incredibly important, right? We see that the explosion of growth in applications, the explosion of communication and testing and working through the application space is just It's really, really just happening fast, right?
Yes, it is.
And then, like you were saying, you sprinkle AI on top of things, it just gets even more crazy. I'll tell you, an interesting stat I have, right? Like, I'm always coming up with stats because that's what I do, I'm an analyst.
You're the stat king. App dev and stat king over here
okay,
to my left.
Okay, all right, I'll take that. But like, you know, a year ago I ran a study on AI adoption and production applications. We saw that 18% of applications, production applications were using AI in production applications. We reran that study about 9 months later and found that that number went up to 54% in just a short amount of time, right? And that's now I would say that that's probably even much higher. So we also see the number of applications being increased, and there has to be a need for that moving from a test environment to a production environment in a seamless fashion. And the gateways of connecting these things together really, really matter. So that's kind of where I'm seeing a lot of those.
Are you noticing the same things
in
absolutely. Your conversations?
Absolutely. And what is happening on top of what Paul just added, what that's creating is making it very easy for people to deploy applications, create applications, and deploy them, but it's happening without any kind of guardrails, without any control, any governance, any of that security layer.
It's kind of chaotic.
So it's the Wild West of that,
which
is okay when new technology is coming out, but very quickly, if they're moving to production, you need those guardrails in place. And that's why
it gets real messy real fast.
That's why you need the building blocks like a gateway in the middle, and the gateway can take many shapes and forms. So you have the API gateway. This was the pre-AI era. In the post-AI era, that API gateway needs to manifest into an AI gateway because the same challenges abound, right? You have control authentication issues, you have security issues, and with AI, now you have a data privacy issue. Like, how are you going to govern all of that? And at the pace at which app development is happening, if you don't put these controls in place, bad things can happen very fast.
Bad things can happen very fast. It can be extremely costly. You can be fined depending
absolutely.
On the
situation that we're in.
Absolutely,
there are real liabilities.
I mean, this show tends to be a lot about decreasing complexity in our space, but there's also, what you're talking about is really decreasing risk.
Absolutely.
I can imagine. So you work with a lot of really interesting players in the space and partners in the space. Talk to me a little bit about those and how you work together, both on the curation of these toolkits and guidelines, as well as ensuring that things that are deployed aren't in that risky territory.
Yeah, so I'll say maybe a couple of things on that. One is what we're doing, especially at this KubeCon, one of the key themes for us is better together.
Yeah.
And we have a big belief that customers don't use one or a set of technologies in a vacuum. It's part of a bigger picture, a bigger architecture, so to speak. So our job, at least we want to do our part, which is to make sure we give them these curated reference architectures on how we fit into our partner stack.
Yeah.
And that was the genesis of these better together reference architectures that we put in place. And we were demoing that at four of our key partners at this KubeCon. You know, we started with Nutanix, where Traefik is embedded into their Nutanix Kubernetes platform and their next generation architecture, the AI architecture, which is the Nutanix, the NAI, which is their generative AI product. So we are putting together this architecture to show customers how to deploy this at scale with the right security. Similarly, we're doing that with Akamai. Mm-hmm. We're doing that with Oracle, with their OCI cloud. And we're also doing that with Azure, with AKS.
You've got friends in some really important places, it sounds like.
Startups need friends.
Yeah. I think we all need friends.
We all need friends, absolutely.
Let's talk about how AI is enabling development. Lots of hallway conversations, debates about if AI takes jobs from developers, if it means there's going to be more. We've had some really good hot takes on the show this week. Curious about your perspective.
Yeah, and so we see a bit of both. And we are embracing AI internally at our company as well. And we're really, so when I discuss AI with my team, the way I kind of, my perspective to this is, yes, AI is going to make some tasks optional for humans to do, but that doesn't mean you don't need humans. Each one of us have to elevate ourselves and ask ourselves, if AI can do three things that I used to do out of my 10 things that I had to do, okay, well, how can I elevate myself and how can I get better and build on top of what AI is able to do?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is on the consumption side of it, that we're embracing it ourselves. So we're eating our own dog food. Mm-hmm. On the flip side of it, what we are seeing happen with AI is there's a lot of testing that was happening, back to what Paul said earlier, but we're seeing people move from testing to actually deploying this at scale. And when you start deploying this at scale, you see new problems and new challenges that's come up.
Oh, yeah.
And so because we're embracing AI, we're also able to internalize some of those challenges ourselves, so we're able to put out better solutions, because you know we have the real world experience deploying AI for ourselves.
Yeah, you got to do it to know it.
That's right.
What are some of those challenges that you find are common amongst your community and even for you internally, if you're comfortable sharing?
Yeah, there's three broad types of challenges that we see. The first is the cost and the scale challenge. So as you know, AI requires expensive CPUs and GPUs to run models on. So one of the cost optimization strategies many of our customers are using is the use of caching. And in the world of AI, it's semantic caching.
Right.
So if you have asked AI model a question and you have received a response, and if 10 other people ask variations of that same question, you don't need to compute with those heavy CPU, GPU resources. That answer is already available. So why not cache it and be able to present that answer so you have a better, from an application standpoint, a better user experience and you're able to save cost, do it faster, but then also deploy this intelligence throughout the enterprise, places where you can't even put a GPU and run a GPU if you wanted to.
It's not all about GPUs. I feel like that's that obviously, I mean, I'm sitting here, I have a Run GPUs sticker literally on my laptop right now, so it feels a bit ironic. But on the flip side, you know, there's this focus with NVIDIA and with the GPU conversation, but the reality is we're going to be running small models in a lot of places at the edge. We're going to be leveraging the CPU, the NPU. There's a lot of different things, the LPU from Grok. So there's, you know, I think there's a lot of a little bit of overinflation around that type of silicon, in my opinion.
So what's happening is inferencing, you may hear that term being used a lot. So AI inferencing is on the rise, which is essentially about using AI.
Mm-hmm.
Because training AI, which had been the dominant kind of way of like using GPUs, that was about creating AI.
Yeah.
But now that a lot of these models already exist,
and are open
what do you
source
do with them?
And
they're open source, which means you can bring them in your walled gardens, you can control where it runs, how it runs. You can also control the inputs and outputs.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's about, okay, using it and putting real kind of data through it for it to really do its job, which is to make predictions. And that's what these AI models do.
I mean, inference is what makes AI real for the rest of us.
That's right.
Essentially.
That's right.
For the not super deep silicon nerds like we are.
I also think, you know, Sudeep, you mentioned the fact we talked about the AI taking jobs, the developer jobs, and I think it's a myth. I think we need to like debunk that myth right away. It's going to be a change, right? What we're seeing is there's basically, you know, AI being put in place to accelerate some of those tasks that in the CI/CD pipeline and using these applications and these things that need to be produced.
Right.
But the problem is that there are organizations that I talk to are saying, well, we put out code and it wasn't our fault it doesn't work, the AI wrote it. It's like there's the accountability piece.
Oh, I don't like that, ew,
right.
That's
gross. The accountability is still with the organization. So there are people that, there needs to be a human in the loop.
Yeah.
Right, and I think that happens with the acceleration of these codes, also the inferencing piece as well. They have to be looking at how this code is being used. All of it really is a new skill set and you have to adapt. That's what I think is
absolutely. And the people that adapt, and this applies to us as well, and this is what I tell my team, the people who are able to adapt in this AI age are the ones that are going to get ahead.
So, yeah.
Because they're going to be able to leverage AI and use it to fuel their competitiveness in the market and their innovation. So now small teams can compete where previously, you know, they couldn't, size mattered, but now size doesn't matter because your team can be much, much more efficient and innovative.
Absolutely. Let's talk about, we're talking about decreasing complexity. Let's talk about a little bit of the API complexity and the challenges that are there.
Absolutely. So this is where we see the world of AI and the world of APIs intersecting, and they're very interdependent and very complementary. And let me expand on that a little bit. So if you go back to the inferencing use case, so you bring all of these smaller LLM or smaller trained models in-house, which means you're doing inferencing at scale. And the way to expose these AI models is through an interface, which we already know, it's an API.
Right.
And that is the common deployment pattern that we see.
Yeah.
So the more AI you deploy at scale, the more APIs you have, and then the more APIs you have, it creates an API management problem.
Yes, it does.
So you need almost three things working in unison. You have the AI models, you have the API infrastructure, and you have the API management infrastructure. They all need to work in concert with each other.
Well, how are you helping customers do that?
So we already have the API infrastructure and the API management infrastructure, and AI just plugs nicely in because the foundation is still Cube native, cloud native. Mm-hmm. It's microservices oriented. So you just bring AI in. What AI does is just fuels the API, kind of the explosion that we've already been seeing for the past many years.
Well, let's also not forget bridge the gap between the old and new, right? You have heritage applications that are out there, right? And those heritage applications need to connect to new systems of engagement. APIs allow for that connectivity, allow for that seamless connectivity, and also connecting into the new LLMs that are being created and the SLMs that are being created. So I think that's where there's a lot of forward looking.
Right.
And educating the market is also very important, right? Because there's traditional ways of doing things and then there's new ways of doing things.
Yeah.
So I think maybe if you can talk a little bit about some of those areas that, you know, like some of the test cases that we were talking about and sandbox environments, that might be a good place to kind of talk about it as well.
Yeah, there's a lot of noise in the market about AIs, and a lot of people don't know where to get started. And this is why, back to the reference architecture, like we're creating these prescriptive cookbooks for them to get started and not get stuck when they want to scale. So you lead them down a path where they can start small in a sandbox type of environment, you know, whether they want to start with an AI or an API or a mocked version of an AI or an API, they can test it out. They can figure out their workflow, all their integration points, and then they want to scale. And this is where the infrastructure plays a huge role in enabling this journey from testing to production to scale.
Yeah.
And that's what we're seeing. That's what we're seeing our customers ask for. Like, they don't want to go down a path using tools that cannot scale. And having the right infrastructure from the day one is so critical.
And that's, you have a unique perspective of how to deliver that, right?
That's right.
That's what I'd like to kind of unpack a little bit.
So, we start with giving our users a set of open source tools. so they can start deploying that. You know, similarly to how small models are, a lot of them are open source. So customers look for open source technologies to get started on this journey. And that's what we at Traefik Labs provide, is the what we call the first leg of the journey. It's a three-leg journey, but the first leg is start with open source components, build out the infrastructure, the environment, make sure everything works, you're comfortable, you see exactly the code that you're, you know, what it's doing, how it's doing things, where data is going in and out, and you do it inside your controlled environment. Once that works, then you go to the next stage, you add on capabilities. It's a very modular, progressive, and a seamless journey.
Love that. No wonder you've got such a great community and so many friends in your partner network. You're really offering a lot. All right, Sudeep, I've got one final question for you.
Yep.
When we're hanging out at KubeCon in Amsterdam this time next year, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today?
Interesting question. Well, let's say there's probably going to be more things coming our way that we don't even know. So there'll be more surprises. I fully expect that. But I'm hoping...
Is it a surprise if you expect it?
Well, that's the thing. I expect a surprise, but I don't know what the surprise is going to be.
Okay.
There'll probably be 10 more technologies that I will have to wrap my head around what they do and how I can integrate them. But apart from that, I hope that more and more people would have gone down the path of this prescriptive route. There'll be more success stories, less confusion, and maybe there'll be more open source projects that are going to help the user community, especially the KubeCon community, kind of, you know, work together and then figure this out. And hopefully we'll have more partner stories to tell.
Well, we look forward to telling those stories with you, Sudeep. Thank you so much for taking the time to hang out with Paul and I during such a busy week.
My pleasure, thank you.
Yes, and thank you, Paul. This has really been a joy.
It's been fun.
I've loved sitting on the desk with you. Thank you for all of your fantastic insights. And thank you to all of the fantastic folks you cannot see behind the screen. We've got the Henderson brothers, we've got Christian, we've got Anderson, we've got Frank, and of course, Rob Streche, who sat on the desk with me all week. Most importantly, thank you for tuning in to our 3 days of coverage here. We've done 30 segments, we've had about 50 guests, and we have had so much fun in London, England, at KubeCon, CloudNativeCon. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.